AI budding engineers. Welcome to the discussions on the demonstrate design of steel structures as per IS 800-2007. Welcome to the structural engineering lectures. In previous class, we have seen what is a plastic analysis and plastic movement and plastic hinge, and compared to that of the mechanical hinge. In today's class, we shall see the different loads such as dead load, live load, wind load, snow load, special loads, and earthquake loads, as well as the load combinations, conforming to IS 875 Part 1, Part 2, Part 3, Part 4, Part 5, and IS 1893 Part 1 2016. Now, these are the different codes which we'll be referring in this discussion, students. Right? Now, let us move back to the discussion, student. Right? Now, I'll go to IS 800 and see what are the different loads that need to be considered. Right? Now, the code says that this is how we are there in IS 800 2007, which is the limit state code for steel structures, right? We are there in class 3.2, loads and forces. For the purpose of designing any element, member or structure, the following loads are actions and their effects shall be considered into the account during the designs, right? The one is dead loads, two imposed load, live load, crane load, snow load, dust load, wave load, earth pressure, etc. The third one is wind loads. The fourth one is earthquake loads. The fifth one is erection loads. The sixth one is accidental loads, as those due to blast, impact of vehicles, etc. And the next one is secondary effects due to construction or expansion resulting from temperature changes, differential settlements of the structure as a whole or of its components, eccentric connections, rigidity of joints, differing from design assumptions, right? These are the different types of loads need to be considered, right? Now let us see one by one the dead loads should be in conformation with IS 875 Part 1, and the imposed loads should be in conformation with IS 875 Part 2, while wind loads should be in conformation with IS 875 Part 3, earthquake loads should be in line with IS 1893 Part 1. Part 1. Now let us see these codes at a quicker pace, students. Right? Now I'll move to the very first code. This is how IS 875 Part 1 1987, the Indian Standard Code of Practice for Design Loads other than earthquake for buildings and structures. For buildings and structures. Part 1, dead loads, unit weights of building materials and stored materials. Right? And stored materials. Now let us see the discussions wherein here I do have the now code says that the minimum requirement pertaining to the structural safety of the buildings are being covered in this code by way of laying down minimum design loads which are to be assumed for dead loads, imposed loads, snow loads and other external loads the structure would be required to bear, right? Whereas it has five parts. This I-75 has five parts. Part 1 deals with the dead loads, Part 2 with imposed load, Part 3 wind loads, Part 4 snow loads, Part 5 special loads and load combinations. Special loads and load combinations. Let us move to this first part. We are there in IS-875 Part 1 1987, students, right? Where I do have the unit weights of building materials. Building materials are given in this table 1, right? Where I do have this table containing the columns material and nominal size or thickness in terms of mm and weight or mass in terms of kilonewton and in terms of kg. And its units, whether is it per meter or is it per meter square or per meter cube, that unit is also given, right? That is how now you can see, for example, acoustic materials, right? Now let us say the glass fiber, right? The nominal size or thickness 10 mm. Now its weight is 3.8 × 10⁻³ kilonewton per meter cube, right? That is how the units are given, right? And like that, you please see aggregate, coarse aggregate, right? That of the broken bricks or broken stone ballast, right? Or aggregate, fine aggregate sand, right? Having a density of 18.05, 15.10 to 9.90 brick dust in the form of surki, right? Even like that, aggregate organic or asbestos cement, building pipes, and other materials can be seen here, right? Asbestos cement gutter, right? So on and so forth. Bituminous bitumen blocks, boards, and the standard hardboard, all other hardboards, right? Fire insulation boards, gypsum plaster boards, etc., right? And next we would have bricks, common burnt clay bricks, 15.7 kiloton per meter cube to 18.85 kiloton per meter cube, right? And so on and so forth, right? Brick dust, surki, right? And cast iron manhole covers, right? Of circular HD or double triangle HD, etc., right? Cast iron manhole frames and the cast iron pipes, cement, ordinary and aluminum cement, 14.1 kiloton per meter cube. Rapid hardening cement, 12.55 kiloton per meter cube. Or in terms of kgs, they are respectively 1440 kg per meter cube and 1280 kg per meter cube. And cement concrete, plain cement concrete, aerated, 7.45 kiloton per meter cube, and so on and so forth up to the with formed slag aggregate, 9.4 to 18.05. Now, with sand and gravel or crushed natural stone aggregate, it is 22 to 23.5. Generally, we will take this value in design students, right? Now, like that, cement concrete pre-stressed, 23.5 kiloton per meter cube, right? Cement concrete reinforced, varying from with 1% steel to 5% steel, varying from 22.75 to 26.5 kiloton per meter cube, right? Like that, student, you can see the other different materials are given. Different materials are given, right? Now, let us see the other iron. It is having a pig iron, gray iron, white iron, or cast iron, or wrought iron. Their density is varying from 70.6 to 75.5 kiloton per meter cube, right? Like gypsum, lime, masonry block, right? Masonry stone, and mastic asphalt, right? And mortars, pressure pipes conforming to class A, class B, etc., right? Plated pipes, vertically cast socket spigot pipes, etc. All these are available. Their unit weights are available. Now let us see the soils and gravels, right? And steel sections, hot rolled steel section, right? ISMB sections, right? ISMB 100, their unit weight, right? 0.113 kg per meter, right? 0.113 kiloton per meter, or 11.5 kg per meter, right? That is how ISMB 100, ISMB 125, so on and so forth, right? All other beam sections, right? And followed by the column sections, SC 100 to SC 250, channel sections, MC 75 to MC 400, and other angles, equal angle sections, unequal angle sections, and cold form light gauge structures conforming to IS 811, right? Light gauge angles of 100 by 100 with a thickness of 3.15 to 4, right? Their weights, so on and so forth, right? Channels with lips, had sections, hat sections, rectangular block sections, square sections with different size, rolled steel T-bars, ISHT, ISJT, so on and so forth, and stone, and timber, tiles, terrazzo, etc. Right, and as well as the timber, and that is how the different materials are covered here. Right, now next, building parts and components. Right, the unit rates of these building parts or components are also covered here in this table two, like this. Right, one, the ceiling, right, nominal thickness 1.3, then its weight is 0.23 kiloton per meter square or 25 kg per meter square. That is how for different ceilings, cement concrete plain concentrated cement concrete, right, earth fillings, the finishings, floorings, and floor wood, hardwood, etc., and roofing, as best as sheeting, right, say 0.83 kiloton per meter or 85 per meter square or 85, and so on and so forth, right, walling and store and miscellaneous materials, right, such as say agriculture and food products, right, sugar, seeds, straw and chaff, etc., are chemicals and allied materials, right, and plastics, oil, lins and fuels, right, coke, coal, manures, metals, alloys, cobalt, copper, gold, iron, lead, silver, zinc, alloys, brasses, right, bronze, German silver, gold and copper, right, are there alloys, miscellaneous materials such as aggregate, coarse aggregate, astral coal, dry, 12 mm under, right, so on and so forth, glass or gypsum, calcined gypsum, leather, right, ores, textile paper and other materials, etc. That is how the different densities of the materials are covered in this codal specification. Now let us move back to the IS 875 part 2 students, which deals with imposed loads. This is how the code of practice for design loads other than earthquake for buildings and structures. Imposed loads are live loads, whereas here the different topics that are covered are like this, right? We do have the different definitions, terminology. You may just go through this terminology, students, right? What is imposed load? Imposed load is defined as the load assumed to be produced by intended use or occupancy of a building, including the weight of movable partitions, distributed, concentrated loads, load due to impact and vibration, and dust load. Right? This is what defined as the imposed load, right? Whereas now I do have the keeping in with the occupancy or the use of the group. The classification is like this: assembly buildings, right, where people congregate or gather. The examples are theaters, motion picture houses, assembly houses, city halls, marriage halls, town halls, auditoria, exhibition halls, museum, skating rings, gymnasia, or restaurants, or worship, dance halls, clubhouses, or passenger stations, terminals of air, surface and other public transportation services, or recreation pairs and stadia. All these will come under the example of the assembly buildings. The second definition is building, business building, students, where the buildings which are used for transaction of business, for example, office, bank, professional establishments, courthouses and libraries, etc., right? They fall under the category of the business buildings. The third one is office buildings. Office buildings means which are used as an office are for office purposes. Office purpose includes the purpose of administration, clerical works, handling money, telephone, telegraph operating, operating computers, calculating machines, etc. And clerical work includes writing, bookkeeping, sorting papers, typing, filing, duplicating, punching cards, or tapes, drawing, or matter for publication of the editorial preparation. All these fall under the category of office buildings. Right. The next one is educational buildings. These are used for school, college, or the daycare purpose involving assembly for institution, education, or recreation. Right. These are what educational buildings. The fourth definition is industrial buildings. The industrial buildings means the products are materials of various kinds and properties are fabricated, assembled, or processed like assembly plants, power plants, refineries, gas plants, mills, dairies, factories, workshops, etc. Right. Next one is institutional buildings. Right. Institutional buildings means which are used for purpose such as medical or other treatments. Other treatments in the case of persons suffering from any physical or mental illness or disease or infirmity, right? Or care of infants, right? Convalescents or aged persons or for penal or correctional detention. The example for this one are here where we use ordinarily provide sleeping accommodation in these institutional buildings, right? It includes the example are the hospitals, sanatoria, custodial institutions, penal institutions like jails, prisons, and reformatories. Right? These fall under the category of institutional buildings. Next one is mercantile buildings. Means the buildings which are used as shops, stores, market for display and sale of merchandise, either wholesale or retail. Right? All this come under the mercantile buildings. Right. Next one is residential buildings. Right. Means these include the buildings in which sleeping accommodation is generally provided. Generally provided for normal residential purposes, with or without cooking or dining or both the facilities. The example for this one is multifamily dwellings, apartment houses or flats, or lodging rooms, or restaurants, or hostels, dormitories, residential hostels. Right. Next one is dwellings. These include the buildings are part occupied by members, single or multi-family units with independent cooking facilities. The example for this one is apartment houses or flats. And the last one is storage buildings, means which are used primarily for storage purpose or sheltering of the goods or wares or merchandise, like examples warehouses, cold storage, freight depots, transit sheds, storehouses, garages, hangars, truck terminals, grain elevators, barns, and stables. Right? These are the different types of the buildings, right? For which the code says that what should be the loads, imposed loads, right? Now let us see this table one, student, right? We do have occupancy. Just now we have seen the different types of the occupancy, residential building, and uniform distributed load, UDL, so many kiloton per meter square, and concentrated load, so many kiloton. Now let us see one example, right? Dwelling houses, right? Means where flats, apartment flats, right? All rooms and kitchens, right? 2 kiloton per meter square, and in addition to that, concentrated load of 1.8 kiloton. And all the toilets and bathrooms, 2 kiloton per meter square. And the corridors, passages, staircase, including the escape and storerooms, 3 kiloton per meter square. Whereas balconies, 3 kiloton per meter square. Balconies, 3 kiloton per meter square. Whereas for corridors, the concentrated load is equal to 4.5, right? Whereas for balconies, 1.5 meter run concentrated at the outer edge, right? That is the dwelling units planned and executed in accordance with IS 8888 are the hotels, hostels, boarding houses, etc. Right, residential clubs, right, or boiler rooms, or garages, or institutional buildings, say such as classrooms 3 kilometers from the square, right? Or office lounges and staff rooms 2.5, or the storerooms 5 kilometers from the square, or libraries and archives 6 kilometers from the square for a minimum height of 2.2 meter plus 2 kilometers per meter square per every meter height beyond 2.2 meters for libraries, where stack room for stack areas, right? Whereas for reading rooms it is 4, whereas reading rooms with separate storage it is 3, reading rooms without separate storage it is 4, right? So boiler rooms 4, corridors 4, right? Next one is institutional buildings, right? Where in the bedrooms, wards, wardrooms, dressing rooms 2 kilometers from the square, kitchen and laundries, etc., 3 kilometers from the square, and so on and so forth, right? Next one, assembly buildings. We just go through these students, right? Business and office buildings, let us say the rooms for general use of, with separate storage 2.5 kilometers per meter square, rooms without separate storage 4 kilometers per meter square with a concentrated load of 4.5 kilometers, right? Banking halls 3 kilometers per meter square, and business computing machine rooms 3.5, right? Record files or store rooms 5 kilometers per meter square, or vaults and strong rooms 5 kilometers per meter square, etc., right? And merchandise buildings, now you can say wholesale shops 6 kilometers from the square, just retail shops 4 kilometers from the square, or office rooms 2.5 kilometers from the square only, right? And the toilets at 2 kilometers from the square, and boiler rooms 5 kilometers from the square, and corridors and passages 5 kilometers per meter square plus 4.5 kilometers concentrated load. Whereas industrial buildings, right? Here the work areas without machinery or equipment just minimum 2.5 kilometers from the square, whereas work areas with machinery equipment, so light duty machines 5 kilometers from the square, medium duty 7 kilometers from the square, heavy duty, right? Heavy duty 10 kilometers from the square with each of concentrated load 4.5 kilonewton, right? Whereas boiler rooms 5, right? Like that, right? Whereas next one is storage buildings. Storage rooms on other than cold storage warehouses, right? 2.4 kilometers per meter square per each meter of storage height with a minimum of 7.5 kilometers per meter square. Cold storage to be calculated but not less than 5 kilometers per meter square for each meter of storage height with a minimum of 15 kilometers per meter square, right? Like that, boiler rooms and plant rooms 7.5 kilometers per meter square with concentrated load of 4.5, right? Next, if we see this, now let us see the next heading as loads due to light partitions, right? In office and other buildings where actual loads due to light partition cannot be calculated, right? It cannot be assessed there. Now the court says that due to these finished partitions, a minimum of 1 kilometer per meter square shall be considered, right? And a maximum of 1.5 kilometer per meter square shall be considered, right? Lower bound is 1, upper bound is 1.5 kilometer per meter square, and with a total weight per unit length not greater than 4 kiloton, right? That is all. Next one, reduction in imposed loads on the floor student side. Now, if you have multi-story buildings, now the loads can be, live loads can be reduced on such multi-story buildings. Then this is how the number of floors, right, to be carried by the member under consideration, one floor, then reduction in total distributed imposed or live load on all floors due to be carried by the member under consideration percentage, right? Right, one. For the first one, no, nothing, right? For the second one, 10%, right? For the third floor, 20%, fourth floor, 30, right? 5 to 10th floor, 40%, right? Over 10th floor, 50%. However, no reduction shall be made for any plant or machinery, right? Where the load intensity is 5 kiloton per meter square or more, right? Or more, then no reduction should be done for the live load. For the live load, right? Now let us see the next discussion is like this: the imposed loads on the roofs, right? And the concentrated loads on the roof coverings, and the loads due to rains, dust loads, load on members supporting the roof coverings, and imposed horizontal loads on the parapets and balustrades, right? And grandstands, there also how much of load should be taken, horizontal force applied to seats, 0.35 kN per linear meter on such grandstand, that is also given, right? Now let us see the loading effect due to impact and vibrations, right? Impact allowance for lifts and hoists and machinery, right? Now we'll see that. Before that, let us see this table to impose loads on the various types of the roofs, right? Like this type of roof, uniformly distributed imposed load measured on plan area, and minimum imposed load measured on plan, right? Now first one, flat sloping or curved roof with slope up to and including 10 degrees. Access provided, yes, 1.5 kN per meter square, and minimum imposed load measured on plan is 3.7 kN. Whereas access not provided, then 0.75 kN per meter square, and this minimum imposed load is 1.9 kN. Whereas sloping roof with slope greater than 10 degrees, then for roof membrane sheets or purlins, 0.75 kN per meter square minus 0.02 kN per meter square for every increase in the degree greater than 10 degree slope, right? Subjected to a minimum of 0.4 kN per meter square. Whereas for curved roofs, it should be taken like this as 0.75 minus 0.5 to gamma square kilometer per meter square, where gamma is equal to h by l, where h is the height of the highest point of the structure measured from the springing, and l is the chord width of the roof if singly curved, and shorter of these two sides if doubly curved, right? That is subjected to a minimum of 0.4 kilometer per meter square. Now once we see this, let us see this impact allowance for lifts and hoist and machinery, students, right? That is how you may just see the horizontal loads on parapets and parapet walls and balustrades also, right? They're also given, right? Now these impact allowance, right, for frames and supporting lifts and hoists, 100% for foundations and footings and piers supporting lifts and hoisting apertures, 40%, right? For supporting structures and foundations for light machinery shafts or motor units, 20%. For supporting structures and foundations for reciprocating machinery or power units, 50%, right? That is how the impact allowance should be made for the lifts and hoists, right? Now next one is the impact allowance for crane girders also, right? Crane girders also. Now let us see that the vertical load for electrical overhead cranes, then additional load, 25% of the maximum static load for crane girder for all classes of the cranes, right? Whereas vertical loads for hand operated cranes, it is 10% of the maximum wheel for crane girders only. Horizontal forces transfers to the rails for electrical overhead cranes with trolley having rigid mast, then it is 10% of the weightage of the crab and the weight lifted by the crane acting on any one crane track rail, right? And for all other electric overhead cranes and hand operated cranes, it should be 5% of the weight of the crab and weight lifted by the cranes. Whereas the horizontal traction forces along the rails over the overhead cranes, either electrically operated or hand operated, it should be 5% of the static wheel loads, right? Now once we see this, let us see the crane load combinations, right? Vertical loads, right? And how the combination should be taken. Now the code says that the combination shall be taken for vertical loading, right? Two adjacent cranes working in tandem with the full load and with overloading according to class 6.3, and for long span gantries where more than one crane can come in the span, and the other shall be designed for one crane fully loaded with overloading plus as many cranes as can be accommodated on the span, but without taking into account overloading according to class 6.3, right? And lateral surge, right? What is the lateral search, right? That is of the for single bay frames, the effect of one crane in the bay giving the worst effect shall be considered for calculation of the lateral search. Whereas for multi bay frames, effect of two cranes working on working one each in any of the two bays shall be taken for calculation of the lateral search, right? Whereas the tractive forces in the right in the direction of the movement of this gantry girder, right? Where one crane is in operation with no provision for future crane, tractive forces from only one crane shall be taken, whereas more than one crane is in operation or there is a provision for future crane, the tractive force from two cranes giving maximum effect shall be considered. Now next one is other loads. I hope student you understood. Now let us see this illustrated example showing the reduction of the uniform distributed imposed load in multi-storied buildings for design of the columns, right? Here already code says that the floor load should not exceed 5 kN per meter square. If at all you want to reduce this by this much of percentage, right? That is the floor, number of floor including that of the top roof, right? This is what the terrace, what means terrace floor, right? It is having the actual load coming onto the column at different floor levels, right? Therefore on this terrace floor 30 kN load is coming, which is transferred onto this column, right? Load for which the column ought to be designed at 30 kN. Therefore from the terrace 30 kN load is coming, therefore this column will take a load of 30 kN. Whereas the next story, right, terrace minus 1, right, from top it is called the second story, right? Therefore there it is having 40 kN, therefore 40 plus 30 70. However, because this is the very first story from the topmost story, then we can reduce by 10%, whereas from the topmost story no reduction, right? Whereas the first story from the topmost story we can reduce by 10%, therefore net effective is 90%, 70 multiplied by 0.9, 63 kN, right? And the second story, right? Second story throwing a load of 50 kN, therefore 50 plus 40 plus 120 multiplied by, because this is the second one, I can reduce by 20%, 80% is effective, 80 multiplied by 120, 96 kN, like that for the fourth floor, right? There I can do a reduction of 30%, therefore 50 plus 50, 100 plus 70, 170 multiplied by 0.7, 119. Then fifth floor, there onwards up to 10th floor, fifth floor, 40% reduction, right? Therefore there is all the summation, 30 plus 40 plus 50 plus 40, up to this 40. Here, for the fifth floor, 40% is reduction, means 60% is effective. Now it works at 126, right? Like that from 5th floor to 6th, 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th floor, right? 10th floor, right? This is our 10th floor. We can do 40% reduction. However, for the 11th floor onwards, greater than 10th floor, 50% reduction can be done. Therefore, now I'll take the total cumulative all the loads coming onto this column and then multiply with 50%. Now it works out 237.5. However, we can see that just above that, load onto the column itself is 261, but I am getting a load which is less than 261. 237.5 is less than 261, therefore it is not acceptable. Code says that yes, even this 11th from the top should also be subjected to a load of 261, not 237, so on and so forth, right? There are not, you can see that 50% is reduced even for the bottommost column also, right? This is only for the design of the columns only, right?
Students, I hope you understood the discussions on this dead load and live load. Now let us move to the discussions on the snow loads. Conforming to this IS 875 part 4 1987, which is the code of practice for design load, loads other than earthquake for buildings and structures, part 4 slow loads, right? Let's see this code at a quicker pace to it, right? What this code says is that this standard deals with the snow loads on roof buildings. Roof should be designed for the actual load due to snow or for the imposed loads specified in part 2. Imposed loads, whichever is more, right? Either you design for snow load or for imposed load, whichever is more. That is what the code says. And now what the note says is that mountainous regions in northeast parts of the India are subjected to snowfall. In India, parts of the Jammu, Kashmir, Baramulla district, Srinagar district, Anantnag district and Ladakh district, Punjab, Himachal Pradesh, Chamba, Kullu, Kinnar, Mahasu, Mandi, Sirmur, Simla and Uttar Pradesh, Dehradun, Tehri, Almora, Nainital districts will experience snowfall of varying depth 2 to 3 times in a year. That is how the code says. Now the notations are like this, right? Please see the notations, students, right? And now the as per this, now snow load in roofs. Yes, the minimum design snow load on a roof area is given by S is equal to mu multiplied by S naught, where mu is dimensionless nominal value of the shape coefficient, right? Where S is the design snow load in pascals on plan area of roof, and mu is the shape coefficient. See section 4, and S naught is the ground snow load in pascals. 1 pascal means 1.2 meter square, right? And the shape coefficients are now given in this class 4. Next one is that is of the shape coefficient for sector types of the roofs, for simple flat and mono pitch roofs, and simple pitched roofs, positive roof slopes, right? What should be the shape coefficients? Mu1, so on and so forth, or mu2, they are now given for different slopes. And next one is simple or multiple pitched roofs, negative roof slopes, two span or multi span roofs. Right? That is how the shape coefficients are given. Next, for simple covered roofs, also the shape coefficients are given, right? Mu2 is less than or equal to restriction, mu is equal to 0 if beta is greater than 60 degrees, right? However, the values are given in the figure, right? Mu is equal to 0.8, that is all, right? Schematically. Next, multi-level roofs. For multi-level roofs also, mu2 is equal to 0.8, mu2 is equal to, mu3 is equal to, these coefficients are given. Please refer back to this, and mu w is greater than 0.8 and less than 0.4, such restrictions, right? Now for complex multi-level roofs, the questions are given here, students, in this figure. And for roofs with the local projections and obstructions also, the questions are given with the restrictions also. What are the restrictions? They are also given there. And shape coefficients in areas exposed to wind. The appendix A may be reduced. The shape coefficients given in this 4.2 so far, what we have discussed, as well as this appendix A, may be reduced by 25% provided the designer has demonstrated that the following conditions are satisfied. Right? You can see the conditions, that if these conditions are satisfied, then you use reduced values by 25%. Right. And next, ice load on wires. However, ice loads are required to be taken into account in the design of the overhead electrical transmission line, as well as communication lines, overhead contact lines for electric traction, aerial mass and similar structures in zones subjected to ice formation. The thickness of ice deposit all round may be taken to be around 3 and 10 mm depending upon the location of the structure. The mass density of ice may be assumed to be equal to 0.9 gram per centimeter cube. While considering the wind force on wires and cables, the increase in diameter due to ice formation shall be taken into consideration, like this, right? Into consideration, right? Obviously, the diameters will now increase. Now, next one is this appendix A, shape coefficient for multiple roofs, right? There, how the shape coefficient should be considered is given. Then let us move to the next course student, which is the part 5, IS 875 part 5, 1967, the code of practice for design loads other than earthquake for buildings and structures, special load and combinations, right, combinations. Now let us see this a quicker pace. The different, now this is how the this code deals with the loads and load effects due to temperature changes, soil and hydrostatic pressure, internally generating stresses due to creep, shrinkage, differential settlement, etc., accidental loads, etc., right? Now first one is temperature effects, right? However, the what are the temperatures that are there in the entire country are given in figure. Now we'll see those figures, right? This figure are isoplates, right? Chart showing the highest maximum temperature for the entire country in the form of contours, isoplates, right? This is a chart showing the maximum temperature isoplate, maximum temperature isoplate degree centigrade, or alternatively you can see this in IS 800 1984 also. There also same figure is available, which is supplied by the meteorological department of this India Meteorological Department, right? Maximum temperature isoplates. Similarly, this next figure is chart showing the lowest minimum temperature, right? Isoplates, right? Once we know these maximum minimum temperature, students, then you know what is the temperature variation. Then you consider into temperature stresses, alpha multiplied by T2 minus T1. Temperature strain multiplied by alpha T2 minus T1 multiplied by L, alpha T2 minus T1 multiplied by E, strain multiplied by N smallest, that's stress, temperature stress, right, or thermal stress. The next one, which one is hydrostatic and soil pressures. However, the design of the structures are parts of the structures below the ground level, such as retaining walls and other walls in the basement floors, and pressure exerted by the soil or water or both shall be duly accounted for the basis of establishment on the basis of the established theories. Due allowance shall also be made for possible surcharge from stationary or moving loads. When a portion or whole of the soil is below the free water surface, the lateral earth pressure shall be evaluated for weight of soil diminished by buoyancy and the full hydrostatic pressure, right? All the foundation slabs and other footings subjected to water pressure shall be designed to resist uniformly distributed uplift equal to full hydrostatic pressure, right? In this context, I'll share my experience, student, in one case where I involved with the checking of the building site, the underground water retaining sump is totally uplifted due to the pressure from the beneath, right, or hydrostatic pressure, right, or due to the pore pressure acting onto the empty water tank. Therefore, when the tank is empty, obviously the check for flotation is important, right? That is how checking the hardening of the foundation under the submerged condition shall be done considering buoyant weight. That is right, that is important actually, right? Buoyant weight, right? While determining the latest soil pressure on the column like structural members such as pillars which rest in sloping soils, the width of the member shall be taken as follows, right? Actual width of the member less than 0.5, then ratio of effective width to actual width 3, right? Beyond 0.3 and less than 1, it should be in the range of 3 to 2. Beyond 1 meter, 2 meter, right? The drilling pressure of the soil in front of the structural member concerned may generally be not be taken into account, right? Like this, right? Therefore, the soil exerting pressure onto such retaining wall or pillar or column having a dimension of B, right? The pressure is exerted from a width of 2B to 3B, right? 2B to 3B, that is all. If that actual width of the member is 0.5, then that ratio of effective width to actual width is 3. That is how beyond 1 meter, then only 2, right? Whether 2 or 3, that depends upon this dimension, right? Sketch showing this effective width of pillar or column for calculating soil pressure. However, this on the downstream, this pressure should be neglected. Actually, it will safeguard the structure, actually, but it should be neglected as per this code. Okay, next one is phatic. However, in such cases, the major checks are the overturnings, right? This is the critical check, actually, check for the overturning as well as check for the sliding. If it fails in the check for the sliding, then you may need to provide a shear key. I'm involved in many of these designs of overturning as well as sliding of the road bridges, students, right? Road bridges where abutments, right? And as well as their retaining walls, right? Now, on some day, I'll share that knowledge to you, right? Now, let us move to the phatic. The phatic cracks are usually initiated at points of high stress concentration. This stress concentration will be caused by the associated with holes or welds, including stray or fusion steel structures, defects in material, and local and general changes in geometry of the members. These cracks usually propagate if loading is continuous, right? And where necessary, permissible stresses shall be reduced to allow for the effects of the fatigue. However, the allowance for the fatigue shall be made for combinations of the stresses due to dead load and imposed load only. Stresses due to wind and earthquake loads may be ignored when fatigue is being considered, unless otherwise specified in relevant course of the practice. Right now, that is how the fatigue loads. And fatigue means because of the application of these for many cycles, right? For millions of the cycles, right? Now, next one is structural safety during construction. All the loads are required to be carried by the structure or any part of it due to storage or partitioning or positioning of the construction material and erection equipment, including all the loads due to operation of such equipment, shall be considered as erection loads. Dead load, wind load, and such parts of imposed load as would be imposed on the structure during the period of the erection shall be taken as acting together with erection loads. Right? You consider these dead loads and live loads along with the erection loads as specified in the course. The next, accidental loads. However, these may be accidental loads arising out of the human action include the following: one, impacts or collisions. The example for this one is the collision by the aeroplanes on the WTO towers, right, causing huge impact force, right? Next one is explosions, even the same caused an massive explosion on the WTO towers and fire. Obviously, that impact as well as impact and collision along with the explosion led to the fire at those levels because of that air fuel spewed on the different floors caught the fire. Therefore, that is all the three were there in the WTO tower failure, right? Accidental loads, all the three were there, right? Let us see this. In most cases, the accidental loads only develop under the combination of several unfavorable occurrences. In practical applications, it may be necessary to neglect the most unlikely loads, right? Now, next one is water impacts and collisions, right? Even coming to the tough, the common sources of impacts are vehicles, right? Let us say if I take a bridge located within the city, such as Hyderabad city, then such bridges may be under the impact of the vehicles, right? Or dropped objects from the cranes, fork lifts, etc., right? Or cranes out of control, crane failures, or flying fragments, right? Therefore, that is how these are the common sources of the impact. However, collision between vehicles and the structural elements. In road traffic, the requirement that a structure shall be able to resist collision may be assumed to be fulfilled if it is demonstrated that the structural element is able to stop fictitious vehicles as described in the following. It is assumed that the vehicle strikes the structural element at a height of 1.2 meter in any possible direction at a speed of 10 meter per second or 36 kilometer per hour. That is how the fictitious vehicle shall be considered to consist of two masses M1 and M2 which during compression of the vehicle produce an impact force increasing uniformly from zero corresponding to the rigidity C1 and C2. It is assumed that the mass M1 is braked completely before the braking of mass M2 begins. Right? The following are the numerical value should be used. M1 is equal to 400 kg, C1 is equal to 10,000 kN per meter of the vehicle is compressed, M2 is equal to 12,000 kg and C2 is equal to 300 kN per meter of the vehicle is compressed, right? Now, next one is safety railings. However, the safety railings put up to protect the structures against collision due to road traffic should also resist the impact as described here 6.1.2, right? And next, crane impact load on buffer stops. The basic horizontal load PY tons acting along the crane track produced by the impact of the crane on the buffer stop is calculated by this formula. PY is equal to MV squared divided by F, right? Where V is the speed at which the crane is traveling and F is the maximum shortening of the buffer assumed equal to 0.1 meter for light duty cranes, and M is the reduced crane mass given by this equation M is equal to 1 by g, right? And next one is that of the explosions, right? However, the explosions may cause impulsive loading on the structure. The example for this one is that WTO tower, right? Internal or even it may be the other ways also, right? Internal gas explosions which may occur occurring due to the leakage of the gas piping or evaporation from the volatile liquids or unintentional evaporation from the surface material, for example fire, right? Or internal dust explosion or boiler failure or external gas cloud explosion or external explosion of high explosive TNT, dynamite, etc. Now, next one, explosion effect in closed rooms should also be considered, right? Internal overpressure from an internal gas explosion in rooms of sizes comparable to residential rooms and with ventilation across areas consisting of window glass breaking at pressure 4 kN per meter square, 3 to 4 machine made glass, 3 to 4 mm machine made glass may be calculated from the following method. Okay, now you please see the method. will not go into that details. Vertical load on air raid shelters. Generally, if at all, air raids are happening along the border of the countries, right? Then we will be constructing the air raid shelters to avoid the due damage to the human beings. Therefore, there now we'll see the characteristic value as regard to the building in which the individual floors are acted upon by total characteristic imposed action of up to 5 km per meter square. The vertical action on air raid shelters generally located below ground level, for example basement etc., should be considered to have the following characteristic values. Buildings up to 2 stories, 28 km per meter square building, 3 to 4 stories, 34 km per meter square, and more than 4 stories, 41 km per meter square. And buildings particularly stable construction irrespective of the number of stories, 28 km per meter square. Now also, in case of the buildings with floors that are acted upon by characteristic imposed load larger than 5 km per meter square, the above value should be increased by a difference between the average imposed action on the all stories above the one concerned at 5 km per meter square. That is how the difference should be increased by this difference, right? Now, however, by the buildings of a particular stable construction, it is understood that buildings in which the load-bearing structure are made from reinforced cast-in-situ buildings, right? That is all. Now, next, this sketch shows the relation between the pressure and the time. Pressure in terms of kilometer per meter square and time. And time in seconds, right? Now, next one. This is the sketch showing the time interval and the pressure. And next, fire. Possible extraordinary loading during the fire may be considered as accidental action. Examples are load from people along escape routes and loads on another structure from structure failing because of a fire. Right? Even the example for this one is a fire on fire caused due to the explosion on the WTO towers. Right? That led to the decrease in the ductility. Decrease in the stiffness of the column, and led to the buckling failure of this WTO towers, right? Because of the fire, right? Now, next one, thermal effect during fire. The thermal effect during fire may be determined from one of the following methods: either time temperature curve, as required for fire resistance in terms of minutes, or energy balance method. However, for energy balance method, the fire load is taken as Q is equal to 12 multiplied by TB, right? Where Q is equal to fire action in kilojoules per meter square for, and TB is the required fire resistance in minutes, right? And other loads such as moisture and shrinkage effects, etc. These all other loads should also be considered, right? The next one is the load combinations. All the load combinations such as dead load plus imposed load means live load plus wind load plus earthquake load or temperature load or dead load imposed load plus wind load or earthquake load as appropriate must be considered, right? Where DL stands for dead load, IL for imposed load, WL for wind load, earthquake load, EL, temperature load, TL, right? That is how the different load combinations should be considered. And the code says that when temperature acts, the wind will not act simultaneously. I hope you understood the discussions what we had in today's class. In today's class, we discussed about the dead loads and live loads and the snow and special loads and earthquake loads, conforming to IAS 875 part 1 dead loads, IAS 875 part 2 imposed loads, IAS 875 part 4 snow loads, IAS 875 part 5 special loads and load combinations, right? In the next class we shall see the IAS 875 part 3 wind loads in the next class, right? If you like these discussions on our YouTube, you try to click like, share, subscribe, comment and turn on notifications. We'll meet in the next class with another discussion. Till then, bye bye students.